You've probably heard of geology or even archaeology, but have you heard of geoarchaeology? Sounds like it's just geology and archaeology put together, and that's sort of true, but it's also an entire field of its own. If you ever thought about how humans interact with the Earth, not just in the past, but in the present, then this is for you. This is Charting Geoarchaeology. I'm Jordan, I'm a geoarchaeologist, so let's get it. Let's start with the hard part, defining geoarchaeology. The geosciences, or earth scientists, study earth, life on earth, and all the processes that make this pale blue dot possible. Archaeology is a subfield of anthropology and focuses on the material remains of the ancient and recent human past. People have attempted to explain the connections between these two fields in a few ways. One definition defines something called archaeological geology, or geology pursued with an archaeological basis. On the other hand, geoarchaeology is defined as archaeology pursued with the help of geological methods. But semantics? To get to the bottom of that, we're gonna do a history lesson. So, we could start earlier, but we're going back to the European Renaissance. During this period, antiquarians, or someone who collects antiques, though not necessarily studies them, were focused on gathering Roman and Greek art. So there were excavations by the elite class to find these treasures and bring them back to their estates, though they weren't up to modern standards. Biblical texts were also considered to be historical facts. In the late 16th century, a man named Archbishop James Usher proposed that the Earth was created on October 23rd, 4004 BC, based on his calculations from the Bible. Fast forward to the 18th century. Catastrophism, or the idea that Earth was shaped by great catastrophes, was popularized by George Cuvier, who believed that God, in the Christian sense, had caused several catastrophes, and the fossils were what was left behind. Then comes along a James Hooton, who comes up with the idea of uniformitarianism, where the idea is that the processes at work today, the physical, the chemical, and the biological, have been at work since the beginning of time. This is where geology starts to come into form. Uniformitarianism basically meant to understand the past, we should understand the present. Pretty simple. As long as we don't take it too literally. There are things that have currently or will happen within the Earth systems that are unique, but we can make relative assumptions about things we can no longer see. Relativity was actually super important to early geology and archaeology thanks to a Danish scientist named Nicholas Steino. Steino made a few key observations about layers of rocks and how they're deposited. The most commonly known of Steino's observations, or his laws, is the law of superposition, and it helped both geology and archaeology to develop into systematic fields. The law of superposition just means that as rocks are deposited, older material is deposited first, followed by younger material. Now, just based on a relative sequence of rocks, or artifacts, we can have an idea of their age. Eventually, this helps build the geologic timescale, becomes the basis for relative dating methods for both fields. But connections between the two fields were also being developed elsewhere in unexpected places. Napoleon invades Egypt in 1798. During the invasion, he brings about 54,000 men and 150 scientists, engineers, and scholars. Some of these scientists are geologists and archaeologists who work together to excavate the region's temples. This ultimately leads to the discovery of the Rosetta Stone and sparked excavations in the Middle East, with geologists providing valuable insight to the archaeologists on these projects. This is happening in the dawn of the Industrial Revolution, which is being fueled by new advances in science and technology, leading to new branches of science. For example, a geologist named Charles Lyell continuously corresponds with his friend Charles Darwin, which helps him write a book called The Origin of Species. From this, we get evolutionary biology, but it also provides a bridge between biology and geology in a field called paleontology. Collaborations like these between different scientists continued, and eventually led to physics and chemistry, giving both geology and archaeology one of the greatest tools. In 1913, an English chemist named Frederick Soddy proposes that radioactivity doesn't have to produce new elements, sometimes it produces the same element with different masses. We now call the same element with different masses isotopes. This observation, along with previous research by a number of scientists, eventually led Bertrand Baldwin to develop a method to determine the age of Earth material. He did this based on a ratio of lead to uranium isotopes inside of a rock. This technique and the ones that followed are called radiometric dating. Baldwin used his technique to estimate that the Earth was not 6,000 years old, as suggested by Usher, but 2.2 billion years old. But even that was initially wrong. Newer estimates based on the refining of Baldwin's method and the development of new instruments pushed that number back to 4.5 billion years old. Sometime after that, in the 1940s, Walter Libby at the University of Chicago developed radiocarbon dating for organic material. Being able to date rocks and things that used to be alive changed both fields. Now, scientists could confidently determine the age of most of human history, definitely everything that has happened over the last 50,000 years or so. With dating techniques and advances in other branches of science, people begin to develop their careers on the boundaries of both fields. Geoarchaeology was slowly grandmothered in by people like Eleanor Gardner, and in the 1970s, Carl Butzer coined the term geoarchaeology. This is not the entire history of either field, but I hope I highlighted the major connections between the two. Both fields are concerned about the past, which is why many people confuse geology for archaeology and vice versa. Having a field called geoarchaeology that basically combines the methods from both but has slightly different names and definitions can make it even more confusing. So for this series, we are defining geoarchaeology as the interdisciplinary study between the geosciences and archaeology. This is the third way people think about geoarchaeology, and in my opinion, it's actually the best way because now we can freely explore both without having trying to qualify either one of them. But people who might try to argue that archaeological geology is different than geoarchaeology kind of have a point. The geosciences and archaeology can have very different focuses even if they're basically studying the same thing. And trust me, it is very frustrating trying to study two fields at once. I double majored in geoscience and anthropology with a minor in geography with a master's in anthropology, and now I'm trying to get a PhD in the geosciences. So yeah, part of the reason I did this is because there really isn't a defined path to become a geoarchaeologist. So in my mind, it made sense to become both a good geoscientist and also a good archaeologist. And that's why I like this third definition and what I'm going to be encouraging throughout the series. To be a good geoarchaeologist, you need to be both a good geoscientist and a good archaeologist. And I'm definitely still trying. Maybe you're trying to decide what major you want to do, or you have an idea, but you just want to make sure. I hope this series gives you an idea. But ultimately, I hope to bring more attention to geoarchaeology. This is a field that can push you to learn and experience the world from the smallest of details to an entire planet and beyond. It pushes you to see the world from the viewpoint of other scientists and scholars, and in a time when humanity has altered the Earth itself, it provides a unique way to understand how all of these pieces fit together. So embrace the frustration and be scientists until next time. Thanks for watching, and please like and subscribe to the channel. Check out our source list, it's right down here, and also on b-sci.org, where you can also leave us a donation. We got a lot of long-term plans for B-Sci, and we can't really do it without you guys. So again, thanks for everything, and we'll catch you on the next one.